you are given a chance to start a movement like Anna Hazare, being an original center of this region, what would be your priority number one?
Okay. Maybe we can take a set of questions. Sanjoyda as well as even I think Sanjeev Barua also spoke about. Sparsely with Bangladeshi migrants who are coming for come and go back, rather than this boundary or the border makes a full-time barrier to the free movement. Perhaps not for the ethnic or indigenous people per se. I don't know how far indigenous people have been able to come to the main towns and cities of Assam and being able to, but I am absolutely in agreement with you. Say another 10 to 20 years, it is going to happen. And the fight may escalate.
Easy, I think. Is the reason of some of the new structure coming up during colonial and the post-colonial period? For example, I think, as we have seen the capitalists from outside Marwari capital or Sarathi capital, this is also, I think, purely the a region of the colonial market. And the second thing, labor. What kind of labor is half and the supply by this migrant from poor country is the one which the native people never like. Say for example in Manipur, the ratio pulling is done by the particular community. Community they thought that full you know pulling one person by another is very you know inferior kind of thing. And other thing like barber, mutti, or whatever the indigenous people look down, these are occupied by the outsider. Other thing is that the imam market or women market in Assam or Nagaland or Mizoram, wherever we have the women market, it is never you know touched by the new urban structure. Surrounding to it, so many new you know structure come in the form of urbanization, which is basically the selling the Indian goods. Indian goods only. So I think the immigrant did not take over any indigenous occupation. I think rather a new working and economic modernization created a sphere for outsider. Certainly I think a change also took place between these two things. One is have, another is have not. I think one is the you know other occupation they have to do it. So a kind of a change of economy and the you know, labors are also taken place in certain thing. I think there is no point for conflict also. I don't know how conflict occurred between because it is not, you know, scarcity of thing that they compete. Marwari capital and the local capital are never compete each other, I think. So I don't know how this turned into a kind of conflict instead of, you know, establishing a, you know, occupational harmony or economic harmony as we have seen in some point of time.
Yeah,
they are a question, right? I will make one comment from that reference frame. So I think that besides socio-economical conflict, it's a political conflict as well. For example, in Tripura right now, there are 70% Bengalis and only 30% indigenous people are living. Mm-hmm. And now these, like before this Tripura election, these indigenous people were asking about Tripura land, that we should have our own state. But I find that this scenario has been copied everywhere. For example, the same thing is happening in Assam because it is becoming a political conflict that people from Bangladesh will come, Bangladeshi Muslims will take away our political rights. That's what I feel. Or Bangladeshi Hindus.
Sir, I am a student of corruption actually. When you were saying that one of the alternatives of finding out who has stayed in Assam till before 1971 is to go through the land records and the land revenue records. But in India, I don't know the case of Assam. I mean, there are cases. I mean, Akhil Gupta's work, for instance, on red tape, then blurred boundaries. These are substantially shown that the land records are actually one of the most difficult documents when it comes to who handles them and how corrupt those documents are. So is the case different in Assam in how these records have been maintained?
Before you ask, I am against that. What I am saying is that instead of asking everybody, those villages which were settled before 1971. At least that record is there. Who owned land, I am not talking of that. But these are villages which were demarcated in 1971. Those were there in existence in 1971. And in Assam, the question is 1971, 24th of March. Whoever was there before that is an Indian citizen. What I am saying is don't disturb those villages. Only new villages, you examine there. Whatever is your modality, you go there and ask them, prove your citizenship. Why should you ask people, you know, who have been there for ages? That is my argument. I am not talking the land records. I am not one of, as I said, any written document, if you ask somebody to produce in a usual situation, it is sad. They will not be able to produce. I have seen many of these so-called Bengali Muslim migrants in Assam. I have been traveling there. They were crying. But we don't have any record, never. My parents did not have, I didn't have, she had not gone to school. And you expect her to give her a birth certificate or a school matric certificate. This is ridiculous. Anyway, I just wanted to, but let me begin with this question first. The question is, if I were to start a movement like Jana, what will be your priority? Well, the priority will be same. Myself, a part of Anahazara movement, I was one of the founder of what they call, quote-unquote, mentors of the workers of the Ahmadi Party at the initial stage. And we broke away along with Bhujendra Jadhav and the gentleman, your sociology professor Anand Kumar. And Prasad Bhutan, we broke away from Ahmadi Party when he found that this party is also going to be other party like, you know, same kind of hierarchy, this thing, they kind of civilian like, and we came out. I was a part of the movement. I think the priority still will be corruption. If you cannot fight corruption, you can't do it. Any alternative politics is impossible if you cannot bring an end to corruption. You can bring an end to corruption by convincing people at the grassroots level that you must not submit to corruption. It's very difficult, I know. So you need to have resistance groups there. If somebody goes to get a paper from the Deputy Commissioner, if there is one person going, I would say from the village, go 20. DC will find it difficult, or his clerk will find it difficult to ask. If he does not do it now, you know, it is not very difficult, he will continue to. So people will have to take that kind of pain to connect it. My priority will be, even today, my priority is the corruption. If I have to start Anna Hazare kind of thing. But when I come to work permit, yes, the proposal is only basically from the body. Immigrants from Bangladesh, that you give them, because they are saying they are illegal citizens, they are illegal residents. Give them work permit. I am saying it will not solve the problem in Assam, because the Assam's grievance is not only against the Bangladeshi. Actually, it is a grievance against all those who come and occupy. Now that is related to the other question which he asked. That do these immigrants actually do the kind of work which the local people do? He is saying he has barbers and cobblers, you know, this kind of thing. Well, the fact remains, how many barbers do you need in a place like Assam? Not many, and in the villages, who cut, this is only in the towns, you have the barbers coming from others. Let me break this news to you. Have you heard of, he must have come here and delivered a large number of lectures, Minal Miri. When he was Vice Chancellor Nehru, in his second term, towards the end of his term, I didn't know before. He's a close friend of mine, though we keep fighting with each other because of political differences and views. We fight, but yet we remain friends. And I used to go to his place, have dinner with him, have a drink with him. This is the kind of relationship we had when he was Vice Chancellor. I realized only during a party he had given that who was his barber. His barber was one of our colleagues who comes from a small tribe, his own tribe. He goes and cuts it. And then when I asked this gentleman, he said, yes, in my village, one elder will cut the, there is no barber there, professional barber there. That is the situation. In the urban areas, how many barbers do you need? Or how many cobblers do you need? Now, of course, cobblers are going away because people do not repair shoes anymore. They buy and sew. Well, and so. Anyway, but that is one thing. Yes, there are certain kind of work which people have done. But which kind of work? Is it only the kind of work which they consider below their dignity, or the work which is troublesome? systems in Assam. Tea garden laborers were brought in large numbers, you know why? The local, first day when they tried to the local laborers, which many of them are Kachari, all of these kind of people, you see. And they went on a strike, demanding higher salary. But they could afford to go on a strike, but you know, this was more than a month, it was a big strike. They could afford to go on a strike because they had something to eat. There was nobody who was starving. So long as they have some amount of security of food at home, these people will not do that kind of work. But when they are absolutely in a starving situation, situation of starvation, virtual starvation, they will do everything. This is what is happening. The begging was uncommon in, you know, Assam villages, among the beggars, because there are people who cannot support themselves. So all that is happening. All these the third gender people, you know, who keep coming, clapping and asking for your money, that culture is not there. In Guwahati, you have that. But there are people who are going to that, you know, they will go if there are economic compulsions. It's not a question of cultural barrier of not doing something else. And therefore, the other thing is, as I was saying, that the conflict was not between two communities and ordinary people. It was between the educated middle classes of these two communities. They were doing competing for the same jobs. I know it myself, and I have written it in SMS, that I am very frank about it, that in 1960s, early 1960s, if I had gone to any railway station, if I had those days, reservation was very difficult to get. If I wanted to get a reservation, in most cases, I'll just go and speak in Bengali. Knowing fully well that the ticket, the fellow who is in the counter selling ticket, the DT, the station master, all of them were Bengali. Postmasters, most of them were Bengali even in 60s. I remember them. I was a young person at that time. Today, they are not. Why? Because just during the movement and after the movement, there was a consensus among these people that we must take these jobs. And people like Nehru Baruah went into State Bank of India and they see all places, railways, Oil India, and said, no, you must appoint local people. Local young people got together. They started applying for jobs. They didn't know how to apply before. All that happened. And today, I walk into any of those places, I don't need to speak in Bengali. But I might come across a border. I might, even in Guwahati, Guwahati University, post office, had a Bodo postmaster till the other day. And initially he was not speaking Assamese, but he started speaking Assamese later on. What I am saying is this, if the middle classes compete for the same kind of opportunity, it's not because they don't know, it is not that, not because the Assamese, the Manipuri does not want to become a clerk, that he hates the Bengali clerk competitor. Because both of them want to be clerk. Both of them, and you look at the, you know, that brings me back, because I am pressed in my memory, it's pressed in my memory. Please, nobody has done this to me before. And I'm writing absolutely false, being false charges in public. He says that, you know, Assamese state, it expanded Assamese territory during the British period. What is the Assamese state? Because why he is Assamese, he means Ahomia. He doesn't go to Kalvi. What is the Assamese state? Go to Dispur. 70% of the secretaries are from outside Assam. One or two of them are from hill states now because of tribal government. But not many. One or two of them. There is hardly any deputy commissioner today in Assam who is an Assamese. Ahomia speaking, you know, Assamese. Very few. These are either tribal people or people from Bihar, Orisha. They come from IAS, most of them. Remember that. And that is controlled here, it is not in Assam. So this is the pressure that is there that one needs to understand. Yes, see the Marwari, look at the colonial pattern and the structures coming. Yes, the market. There was no market before the British came. No monetization in the entire Northeast. That's what Amazon got planted at the front tells you. That even Bullock card was the innovation there. It was such a backward situation. There was no currency, no monetization. Some weekly halfway there were bartered. Exchange of goods. Now, there you have the capital coming in along with the British. Maroris came, Bengalis came. Now, how many riots did you have against the Maroris in Assam? Because the Assamese at the time did not have money to compete with them. You will fight only those who are your immediate competitors. not with a big capital. This is very interesting. Marwaris funded this Assam movement, they gave money. Goenka, I remember, gave money. It's a fact of life. If you go to pages of Doni Gohom, you will see who donated what. And then you will find. But also because the Marwaris are in a small number, and therefore there is large scale of assimilation, and therefore you have a Jyoti Prasad Agarwal, a Marwari, who is supposed to be the pioneer of the modern Assamese poetry, modern Assamese films, modern Assamese literature, one of the high concept of Assamese culture. But that cannot happen. They are very rare. Large number of Bengalis, there are few, one or two. Among the Vishas, yes, but even then, among the Vishas cannot as fluently as Jyoti Prasad will do. Cannot do it. Because that's a small group. Therefore, one should understand that the colonial structures which were new, which came up there, created conditions, but it also created social forces within. If education was not started, if small trade was not available to Assamese, they would not come. During the war, a large number of Assamese mobilized, revenue collectors and officials of British days, became contractors and made money. And we know what they did. Next, they were doing the business of petrol pumps. They were buying them off. And those are now, there are people, Assamese now, who own hotels there. During the Salpa period, when the Alpha was surrendered, a lot of money that the Alpha has collected came along with it. It is invested in Guwahati market. Now there is a competition among the middle class urban Assamese businessmen with the Marwari business, and it's happening. And Marwari initially are trying to placate them, but they will not be able to placate them for a long time. There will be 2 million of them, and they will be fighting. So one should understand that there are reasons for competition, and these competition led to the hatred between two communities. And as I keep saying, that most middle classes make use of nationalism to protect their own interests. And that is
possible. Last question. How do you feel, how do you react when the national anthem of India is presented, whether the North is totally bypassed?
I know. I left to myself
one
job.
And one more, sir.
I would have written a new national anthem. I cannot. But then the point is, one should understand, the hatred is not against the state of India, please remember.
Pardon?
All of us, the hatred is not against the state of India. Hatred is against the expansion of Indian nationalism, quote unquote, not the state. State and nation are two different things, please remember. State gives you citizenship. Every Assamese, every now even the Naga, large majority of them, are proud Indian citizens right here. Ask them to become a Indian nationalist. Follow the Hindu Brahminical tradition. They are angry. And that is the time when they will show you their back. You know the story? Jawaharlal Nehru went for the first time, addressed this huge gathering of the Naga, and said, like he always said, Bhaiyo Bhaino, do you know what the Naga did? And that's what the tribal community can do. All of them turned their back to him and wanted it. The entire mass gathering. And Nehru was never insulted like that, he never forgot that. And he goes back and says, we need to control these people. See, what I'm trying to tell you is, the state of India gives us citizenship. And yes, the national anthem has become a part of it. I know, but then, see, what does everyone we also know? Those of us who know, we realize what the national anthem was meant for. They are not meant for the state of India. They are meant for something else. You know that story? Read some Bengali literature, you will know. There's many people accused that it was.
What I'm thinking is, suppose if you are asked to sing Bharat Mata Ki Jai, and if you are asked to sing Jana Gana Mana Lokmana in movie, every time when you go to the theater, so what is wrong to have a documentation of the citizens or something like equivalent to the NRC? Is that like Tripura, where its existence become, when the existence of the indigenous people become a threat? So why this cannot be a requirement for the right?
Requirement for what?
For Tripura, NRC.
NRC?
Yeah.
my question is that if you have energy in Assam, you will have to have energy all over India. I know it is not possible, but that is my position. That's why I think energy is not right. Why should you make an exception in the case of Assam?
This
large scale, you know, immigration.
Why NRC is not right in the state like Tripura?
Because, see, you should understand this. There is a post like the Assamese nationalist post there, which is powerful. The moment that the UJS and the kind of forces become more powerful than the Bengalis there, or at least substantially powerful to threaten them, they will demand an NRC. Remember that. But Tripura also, I have other, anyway, I will not go into it, but please remember. That it's a fact that the Tripuri tribals did not control the entire state of Tripura. It's not true. History does not tell us that.
Yeah. So you can wind up now the end of the infection, and before just closing it completely, I would like to give my thanks to Professor Baruah for just steering this afternoon for this meaningful and insightful interaction with all of us. And of course, I have to thank, you know, all the participants like research scholar, faculty, or any other, you know, student who are taking interest in research or such talk. I think I would like to thank all of you.
Welcome. And thank you all for not beating me up for being unpatriotic.